The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
In the brotherhood of the working cowboy world, there have been and there will be some names that you'll hear in cow camps, ranches, sale yards, and ranch rodeos over and over. They're not household names, but they command a lot of respect from those who know what it takes to earn the title Top Hand. They're my heroes, and today you'll hear a conversation I had with one of them a few years ago. He's not really comfortable in front of a microphone, but he's perfect harmony when he's on a horse working cattle. From the Nicola Valley to the Caribou, from Alberta to Saskatchewan, he's seen it all from the back of a horse, and his name is Terry Milliken.
I know dang well if that cow comes busting out, they gotta bust out in the cold, they're gonna buck off in their head.
On the Rangeland News, Gary Crawford will play some music and then explain how the music applies to the North American cattle industry.
Prices that will likely increase as supplies of cattle continue to shrink.
And digging down for a story from the vault, quarter horse trainer and breeder Ron Anderson pops up.
Now I'm strapped to the horn because it was hooked over my coat, and she bawled and bucked across the pen, and that button wouldn't let go.
And something really special in the cowboy poetry spotlight. Now see if you could recognize this well-known voice.
I've got my own pony, and that saddle is mine, and that ragged old slicker's for when it don't shine.
Well, I'll tell you who that is, and I know you'll love what he's got when we get to the cowboy poetry spotlight today. And on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, some fascinating facts about the vision of horses and why it makes a real difference if we can understand how it works. Lots of that real music in the West, and we're going to start off with another good one from Randy Houston.
There's a warm wind blowing down off the mountain. The whistle pigs are singing songs of spring. I'm hearing voices, does that mean I'm crazy? Well, I'm waiting for the quitting bell to ring. I guess 8 to 5 doesn't fit my program. It costs too much just to earn this check. This itch I feel is deeper than the bed bugs. It's tighter than the tie around my neck. Dust off your saddle. Voices say, there's a little angel shouting in my brain. The battle of security versus my insanity. The good guys are gonna win the battle. And the voices say, dust off your saddle. Baby calves are banging on the spigot. The meadow larks have shucked their long johns. I'm getting sick of being homesick. In a week or two, they're gonna call me gone. Bet the town folks figure I've gone crazy. Talk to myself and I answer back. I got visions of predestination. It must be a duck if it quacks. Dust off your saddle. The voices say, there's a little shouting in my brain. The battle of security versus my insanity. The good guys are gonna win the battle. And the voices say, dust off your saddle. The voices say, dust off your saddle.
Well, in the brotherhood of working cowboys, one of the well-respected names is Terry Milliken. And he could do just about anything with horses. He's ridden the ranges of three provinces, and now he's making real nice saddles and tack.
Where did you start thinking the way a horse thinks? You know, like I watched you a little bit. I've talked to a lot of fellows that have worked with you with horses, and I can kind of tell the way you approach it and the way the horse is responding that you're reading that horse because you're pretty well on the same wavelength. Did you always approach and handle horses pretty much in the same way, or is this something you sort of changed as the years went by?
I've learned the hard way, I guess, but I've never gave up on a horse. And I don't know, I should have probably lots of times, and I've got my lumps. I had to get this one thoroughbred horse, I had to get him, I had to really expose him to everything because he was going to the track for a pony horse, or not really a pony horse, leading horses to the post and just really being an important horse, and so he had to be pretty broke. And I rode him last summer when I was working up a lot and roped off him a lot, and I really liked the horse. He's really a nice horse. Big. He'd been on the track, and he just didn't work out as a race horse. He liked to run in the middle of the pack. He didn't want to be a winner. But he was a nice horse and a big horse. So I really wanted to expose this horse to everything, and I did. I roped colts. I worked colts off him out here and, roped. Done everything with him, and he just feeling pretty good because the first thing in the spring, and I really open him up and let him go, and let him do whatever he wants. And but I had this other colt. I figured I'd pony him out with his big horse because he's going to be a pony horse anyway. So I was doing all the ponying I could and exposing them to everything I could, and just letting her all hang out. But I don't know what got into. Something spooked that horse I was ponying, and he blew up, and bellering and bucking, he passed me, and I wasn't going to let him go because I didn't want to chase him around because I was supposed to meet Eshon's crew up there. We were gathering to brand. Well, his big bay horse, he wasn't going to be outdone by this gray horse, so he bogged his head and went up bellering and bucking, and I figured I could ride him because I figured I had rode him through some pretty good sessions, but this time,
of course, you weren't about to let the thoroughbred go either.
No, I wasn't going to let the other horse go, so they parted company, and I just kind of got pulled off and bucked off at the same time, and I was looking at a rock, and next thing I know, I was on it.
Broke your fall, huh?
Yeah, with my eye, and my shoulder, and my ribs.
Coming up, Terry was born right-handed, but he'll describe the wreck that made it necessary for him to learn to rope with his left hand when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. How about the 2023 Friends of the Spirit of the West cruise? Well, it happens in January. You will visit six different countries, including the United States, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, Otalco, Mexico, San Juan, Nicaragua, Punta Neris, Costa Rica, Panama City, Cartagena, Colombia, as well as back to Fort Lauderdale. A 15-day cruise on the Emerald Princess, leaving Los Angeles, and a two-day Panama Canal experience. Special group farm tour in Costa Rica, and your hosts will be the official Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you will be amazed, I think, when you see how low the prices are for this one. So just go to our cruise page at q-mcclellan.com or see the cruise Facebook page to find out more. And you can always call the toll-free number, 1-800-530-0131. Did I mention that this one will have everyone flying to Los Angeles on January 16th, 2023? And of course, airfare and hotels are included. And get this, everyone who books this Panama Canal cruise before July 31st, 2022, will get double their regular shipboard credits as returning gifts. That could amount to hundreds of dollars for frequent cruisers and a big kickstart for first-timers. And that number again, 1-800-530-0131. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. As Waddy's poem says, there's nothing like the feeling that you get down deep inside when you trot out in the morning when you've hired on to ride. Well, Terry Milliken got bucked off pretty hard trotting out early in the morning and pretty much did in his shoulder, the one he landed on, and here's how it happened.
Big brown horse. It was just the silliest damn thing. It just jumped out. We're riding out one morning, like I had a crew, 10 guys, I guess, that morning. Just leaving camp, we're heading out. I don't know where we're going, gathered the brand or something. And we're just trotting down the trail. And I just jumped my dog out to take a run at, or my horse out to take a run at my dog. And I don't know, he got his feet tangled up or what, but he just turned a somersault on me right there on the road. Lots of witnesses there.
So there you were. You couldn't get back on.
No, I got back on. I put in the day. And
you did?
Yeah. And I went to the doctor, and then I never missed a day's work. All that summer, I couldn't rope. That's how I started roping left-handed. I healed calves left-handed.
Really?
That spring.
Now, that must have taken some concentration,
well,
or some practice.
If you want to do something, you know, and you got to do something, Jeez. You find a ways and means. And I always did like roping and healing calves. And
yeah.
So I just went to work. And there's a funny thing, too. I was riding a big horse there called Big Bird. He is a big son of a gun, he's good 16-1 and big horse. But I hadn't healed off him before, and I started healing off him left-handed that spring.
Yeah.
And there's no problem. I roped cows, like after we were done branding, anything that had a horn growing into his head or something, we'd rope him, and I'd rope him left-handed. I'd done all my roping left-handed on him.
Wow.
And he was a left-handed horse.
Yeah.
And later on, we had a fall branding in September, all our cleanup, and some big calves. I mean, humongous calves there. And my shoulder was getting a little bit better, so I was roping a few right-handed. You know that son of a gun, I couldn't get him face up right-handed.
Yeah,
he's
so
almost
used to it.
But it ended up, he could rope anyway. But all my horses now, I can rope
left-handed.
Left-handed or right-handed.
Well, there's more of Terry's cowboy savvy coming up, but that'll be right after a song that turned out to be kind of a classic in the working cowboy world. It was written by two of the best, David Wilkie and Stuart McDougall, when they were both part of the Great Western Orchestra. And it's been recorded by Ian Tyson, Randy Travis, and quite a few others. I thought you'd like to hear the original from the guys that wrote it, The Wind in the Wire.
I'd been riding fence all day, way up on the summer range. Found a place to make my bed. As the evening shadows spread beyond the campfire light, through the stillness of the night, came the call of the coyote choir and the song of the wind in the wire. As it strummed the rusted strings, it sang of long forgotten things, many moons and many suns of the real Americans, when the arrow and the bow stalked the range of the buffalo, the call of the coyote choir. as the ghostly balladeer hypnotized me, I could hear bugle calls and battle cries, broken promises and lies. The spirits of the plains still sing their sad refrain. Then the call of the coyote choir and the song of the wind in the wire. Spirits of the plain still sing their sad refrain. Then the call of the coyote choir and the song of the wind.
And now back to Terry Milligan.
When you're putting a crew together for a, you know, a place that needs lots of cowboying to be done, is it getting harder and harder to find young guys that have learned those kind of skills?
Oh, boy, there isn't any. You're damn right, it's hard to find. There isn't any, and maybe one out of ten wants to learn and will learn. You know, most of them, they just like the image.
Watch the shadows after, when they ride.
Yeah, yeah. And after a month or two, they've had enough, and they don't come back. But there's still a few young guys around that can learn and want to learn, and to get guys to ride colts. I always figured that's part of the job.
Yeah.
That's the best part of the job, I think. I mean, the guys that do ride colts, they always end up to be the best cowboys because they learn. They're watching cows because they got to make that move before, you know, they got to know where the cow is.
Yeah.
What the cow is thinking before the cow thinks it, because they got to get that colt over there to do it, and they know dang well if... that cow comes busting out, they're going they got to bust out in the cold, they're going to buck off in their head or something.
That's right, yeah. I see what you mean.
And the guys that never ride colts, they don't ever make top hands. They can't.
It's an old hand that's been doing it for years and years, or a young fella or whatever. It's still nice to see that cowboy pride. You know, it's the pay isn't great by any means, but it's a job that... just not everybody can do, and there are fellows that can do it, and they still do it with some pride, and I just hope that kind of thing continues for a long time.
Yeah, me too.
Coming up, another story from the vault and the rangeland news when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
Ron Anderson, well-known horse show announcer and breeder of fine cutting horses, he sat down with me one time and told me about the real advantage of having a jacket with snap buttons.
And remember one time that we were talking about I was working she was a three-year-old mare, and pretty athletic mare. A little bit green. She hadn't been gone down much, hadn't been rode a whole lot, but very talented mare, pretty athletic, and boy, she could scat and she could get back through herself. And I'd been schooling her, and we were just working her, and I had on a eiderdown vest and a jean jacket over the top of it, and they manufactured this blue jean jacket, had thought it would be really good. It had a zipper in it. And they thought that that'd be pretty good if they put a button at the bottom of that zipper so that if you wouldn't spread it open and rip the zipper out from the bottom. And that's the manufacturer thought that was a good idea. And so I was wearing that coat, and I had that button done up to save that zipper so it wouldn't rip out. And I took this mare, and I doubled her back off the fence, and I spanked her backside with the popper on the end of the rainmaker, cracked out of that turn. She cracked out of the turn pretty good. Her head disappeared between her front legs, and she went to bawling and bucking. And when she did that, the front of my coat went over the horn. And that manufacturer's button held up really good. Now, I'm strapped to the horn because it was hooked over my coat, and she bawled and bucked across the pen, and that button wouldn't let go, and I just felt like a rag on the end of a stick, and I stayed in the middle of her. I'm not much of a bronc rider, but I'm afraid of falling. And it finally let go, but it was a pretty good storm up until then.
Boy, that was just well-designed for riding broncs, wasn't it?
it was a poor choice of clothing. Finally ripped out, and I left it ripped out. I never did fix it. I thought it was better off that zipper open up.
From a radiator cap to an engine block, BZTractorParts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal Deutz Leyland, Landini, Oliver Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com. Just ahead of a busy rangeland news, here's the voices of Cowboy Celtic featuring Denise Withnell and Alberta Cowgirl.
It's 4 below 0 wind out of the west, and her ears flaps are pulled down tight. The cattle are thirsty, horse slips on the ice. It's a safe bet she'll sleep good tonight. Daddy's at sea, great-grandfather came here from way. With a bloodline like that, boys, she ain't for the meat. Get a hold on her or else you a fail. Come a tie-eye, yippee-eye, yippee-eye. Come a tie-eye, yippee-eye. Scotch cap pulled down on the rosiest of cheeks. It's the Alberta cowgirl.
Yippee-yi, yippee-yi, come and tie-yi, with two pairs of pants on to keep out the cold. It's the Alberta cowgirl for me. It's the Alberta cowgirl for me.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, Gary Crawford is standing by with a cattle market analyst. That looks something like the boss standing there with him.
Going over his USDA cattle inventory report sort of reminded me of this old Springsteen song. And indeed, in that cattle report,
the numbers are dropping, both lower cow numbers and lower replacement numbers.
And higher numbers of females being put into feedlots. This from USDA livestock analyst Shale Shagham. The report has the number of beef replacement heifers as of July 1st down 3% from a year ago. Almost everything actually in the report signaling a continued contraction. Shagham says one big reason, of course,
the drought and the tight supplies of forage,
which will continue to influence producer decisions. However, Shagham says they aren't just looking at forage supplies.
You're looking at higher costs of labor, higher costs of energy. These are all factors that the producers are going to be looking at in addition to the price that they are receiving for their animals.
Prices that will likely increase as supplies of cattle continue to shrink. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
The Canadian Cattle Association is pleased to see an increased funding for the next ag policy framework. The agreement includes $500 million in new funding, $250 million of which has been earmarked for a resilient agricultural landscape program known as RALP, and now they're calling it RELP. Tyler Fulton, an officer with the CCA, says that's a program the cattle industry is well positioned to take advantage of. The nature of having cattle on the landscape has really positive ecological effects, he said, not just from a habitat conservation standpoint, but also from adding climate resiliency so far as protecting against floods or fires. And then, of course, the whole carbon sequestration thing. He said they were pleased to see that any environmental outcomes were not tied to agri-stability or crop insurance, adding that they'll have to wait and see the government's plans to connect with AgriInvest. And he notes the CCA was also pleased to see the increase in the AgriStability compensation rate from 70% to 80%. Well, John Deere employees and executives helped to make a young boy's wish come true. Weston Wilson, a 12-year-old from Pine, Arizona, got to visit John Deere facilities as part of his Make-A-Wish experience. In 2019, he was diagnosed with Wilms' tumor. That's a kidney cancer that primarily affects children. And after about 1 year of weekly chemotherapy treatments, Weston is now in remission. And he has loved tractors from the time he was a youngster, and he always wanted to own a John Deere 730, the same tractor his granddad had. Now, knowing that the young boy has gone through a lot, and being able to provide moments of joy was a special honor, said Nate Clark, the president of the John Deere Foundation. And his family, which also includes his mom Shelby and his brother, 8-year-old Aeson, enjoyed all kinds of experiences while they were in Illinois. First at Harvester Works in East Moline on July 14th, and then as part of the tour, he pressed the button to start a new laser system, and he received a laser-cut plaque featuring his name and a piece of John Deere equipment. And maybe the highlight of the whole thing was when they arrived at John Deere's world headquarters, where a lot of employees and executives gathered, including Chairman and CEO John May. They greeted the family, and while they were there, May and Weston signed a document making the young fella John Deere's first ever junior CEO. And despite an import ban early this year, South Korea's imports of Canadian beef spiked in March and April. South Korea banned Canadian beef imports from December of 2021 until January 19th, 22, due to a one case of BSE and an atypical case found in Alberta cow. And January volumes were down 41% from last year, but they rebounded strongly. February, March, and April, they saw record high numbers of over 3,000 tons. Australia and New Zealand say they have stepped up protections against foot and mouth disease at their international airports following an outbreak of the disease in Indonesia.
Travelers arriving in Australia from Indonesia will now be asked to walk across sanitation foot mats at airports, the latest measure to ramp up Australia's biosecurity members. The mats will contain a citric acid solution designed to dislodge any dirt from the sole of the shoe and cover it in the acid. There is a yearling and regular cattle sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op on August the 23rd, regular sale in Williams Lake on the 25th, and a regular sale in Vanderhoof on the 26th. Get all the information and see the sale streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, Innisfail, Alberta, regular cattle sales every Wednesday starts about 9 a.m. with butcher cows and bulls, followed by other classes of cattle. Get the details at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com, and you can call Danny, Mark, or Dwayne at 1-800-710-3166. And that takes us down to the final item. And just the other night, Billy and I were sitting there on the porch, watching the sun go down and talking about some of the things that old couples seem to talk about. And I'm not sure why, but Billy said, "Okay, when you die, where would you like me to have your ashes spread?" I thought for a minute, and then I said, "I don't know. Surprise me." And that's the Rangeland News. Still to come, how horses see our world on the Horse Training File. More from a conversation with top hand Terry Milliken, and another real nice Song of the West when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Coming right up on the Horse Training File, if we can understand how a horse's eyes work and how he sees our world, it would really help us understand his behavior. First, though, how about the 2023 Friends of the Spirit of the West cruise? Well, it happens in January. You will visit six different countries, including the United States, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, Otalco, Mexico, San Juan, Nicaragua, Punteneras, Costa Rica, Panama City, Cartagena, Colombia, as well as back to Fort Lauderdale. A 15-day cruise on the Emerald Princess, leaving Los Angeles, and a two-day Panama Canal experience. Special group farm tour in Costa Rica, and your hosts will be the official Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you will be amazed, I think, when you see how low the prices are for this one. So just go to our cruise page at q-mcclellan.com or see the cruise Facebook page to find out more. And you can always call the toll-free number, 1-800-530-0131. Did I mention that this one will have everyone flying to Los Angeles on January 16th, 2023? And of course, airfare and hotels are included. That number again, 1-800-530-0131.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Here at Irvine Tack and Western Wear, they get it. You're busy. Between work, family, chores, finding time for shopping can be a challenge, right? Solution? Irvine's online. Buy now and take advantage of free shipping on orders over $100. Some conditions apply. Western Wear, with a welcome twist at your fingertips. Visit irvines.ca or stop in today, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield.
Canada's largest Western store.
A couple of years ago, in October, the nightfall caught three of us a few miles away from the trailer after a long day of gathering cattle, and there was no moon, just a few stars, and as one of the guys said, about as black as the inside of a cow. There was no way we could see any landmarks or even where the trail went, but our horses seemed to know exactly where they were going. There was one barbed wire fence about a mile from the trailer with an open slipwire gate that we had to find and ride through. We couldn't even see the fence until our horses walked right through the gate and continued on over the creek beds and sagebrush and around the rocks that we couldn't even see, and all three of them stopped
And there we were, right at the trailer. Two factors were at work here. A horse's incredible sense of direction and their amazing night vision that leads to another concept. The more you know about your horse's vision, the better partner you'll be. Horses have the largest eyes of all land mammals. Their eyes are about 8 times bigger than human eyes. They have a large, nearly circular field of vision with 2 small blind spots right in front of their nose and directly behind them. And the horse will check the blind spots by moving his head, thus compensating for this vulnerability. Humans, we people, focus by having the lens of our eye change shape. But the lens of a horse's eye doesn't change shape the same way ours does, and they focus by moving their entire head. And academic research and empirical evidence suggests restraining horses' heads with rein pressure or martingales or tie-downs is precisely the wrong thing to do when encountering tricky footing or obstacles. Great trainer, now in Montana, Randy Riemann says, "I like to let a horse rearrange his head to get a better view of the landscape. I give him the liberty to do that. How they feel posture-wise is more important than how we feel. Our safety depends on their comfort. If you continually hold on to the horse by rein contact, all the rider information is rendered meaningless. Let the horse balance by dropping the reins, even if it doesn't quite fit with the picture in the rider's mind." And Martin Black says, "As we rein our horses, it's likely for them to feel the need for their head to come up to maintain their balance and focus their eyes." Nothing is more underrated than turning a horse out in rough country. "There they'll use their feet so much better," says Ross Knox, another great trainer and longtime buckaroo. "It's another part of training, and when you haven't turned out in rough country, you don't have to be on them for them to learn."
Well, that kind of turned into more of a lecture than a short piece, but for Urban Saddles and Western Wear, that is the Horse Training File. And you know, our horses are still doing well, even in their advanced age, like I am, and they have the benefit of a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out why it works so well at HoffmansHorseProducts.com. The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years, and the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that Alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork. See PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. Well, there's more from Terry Milliken coming right up. But right now, here's another one from another Terry. This is Terry Brown.
Strong, sturdy breed. When hard work and freedom were all that you need. At times you went hungry, and sometimes you bleed. But you were a cowboy and proud to be. You came along when this country was young. You helped tame a frontier with your fist and your gun. You wanted no trouble, but but you never did run. 'Cause you were a cowboy and tough as they come. You rode in the saddle for days without a rest. You never had school, but you passed every test. And when we needed more, you never gave less. 'Cause you were a cowboy, one of the best. I wish we could go back to like it was then. Life was more simple and men were still men. I would have been proud to have rode with you then. 'Cause you were a cowboy and I could have been.
Well, that's what I call a pretty good song from Terry Brown. And I just want to make sure that you know we've got a darn good piece of poetry from a fellow who's fairly well known in some of the parts where the show was heard. That's in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight. Don't miss it. So what part did working cowboy Terry Milliken find the most pleasurable? Well, he had an interesting answer.
Was there one part of it that you enjoyed more than anything else when you were, you know, starting out doing this to make a living in full time? Was it, I don't imagine it was the field work and the haying that was number one with you. But
no, I never did do much of that, but it was always the horses. I always, you know, if it wasn't for the horses, I sure as hell wouldn't have been cowboying. And I used to tell my crew, too, I said, now, would you be out here doing this if you're on foot? You know, or, so, you know, look after your horse. The horse comes first, always. And to me, the horse always came first. Maybe that didn't... cut it with management or sometimes, but it's always the horse came first. The horse came first before the man too, you know, for the crew, because that horse, he was born on that ranch, and he didn't have any choice in the matter. He had to work there, whereas the man, he came there because he wanted to, and he could leave when he wanted to. And if the horse was getting abused, I'd just as soon see the man go.
Yeah,
things have changed, and it is. They're getting a lot better. Horses are getting treated better.
What kind of things you try and do to maybe break down his flight response and his flight instinct and that kind of thing?
Well, one thing I really, really noticed when, you know, all the years of cowboying, that 99% of the horses and the cowboys, the horse never, ever knew he'd done anything right. Them horses that go through their whole lives never knowing they'd ever done anything right, but if they'd done something wrong, boy, they sure found out about it. So the horse was never, ever, you know, turn loose or relaxed or anything. And boy, that used to really bother me a lot. So I really work at getting the horse to relax, you know, whatever it takes to get him to relax. And it's just makes all the difference in the world.
Well, Terry is building beautiful saddles and writing really neat cowboy poetry these days. And talking about cowboy poetry,
there is a masterpiece coming up, as well as our classic Song of the West segment, When the Spirit of the West, continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Boy, I sure hope you can stay with us for the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, and it will shine on a very special guest. In this week's classic Song of the West segment, we'll look back at 1941. Bob Nolan and the Sons of the Pioneers had already appeared in a lot of B-Westerns with Charles Sterrett as the Durango Kid for Columbia Pictures. And that contract ended in 1940, and then they were signed with Republic to appear with Roy Rogers. And the first movie they made with Roy and Trigger was called Red River Valley. But that's not the song we're looking at today. The movie Red River Valley recycled a lot of songs the Pioneers had done in the Durango Kid films, and there were apparently plans to use the song we're looking at today, which is actually credited to Tim Spencer, but possibly written by Glenn Spencer, in the movie. But so far, nobody's found this song in any of the prints. But so far, an uncut print hasn't been located, so it may still be in the original director's cut. Now, the reference to the Red River Valley obviously points to that well-known old song, The Red River Valley, and anecdotal evidence suggests that song was known in at least five Canadian provinces before 1896. In 1925, Carl T. Sprague, an early singing cowboy from Texas, recorded this song as Cowboy Love Song, and it was fellow Texan Jules Verne Allen's 1929 Cowboy Love Song that gave the song its greatest popularity, and apparently it was originally brought over from Europe. In any case, this is the song that may or may not have made it into that first movie the Sons of the Pioneers did with Roy Rogers for Republic, done here by the Sons of the San Joaquin. So long to the Red River Valley.
So long to the Red River Valley.
Now it's great to welcome to the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight a guy who's a fine singer and songwriter himself, and a well-known radio personality who's dedicated his entire career to supporting great country music performers. The much-loved radio personality Pete Hicks and a poem he wrote.
About everyone knows I'm Alberta's true child. Been a little bit crazy, I've been a little bit wild. Some say I've got grit, some say I've got sand. But everyone knows I ride for the brand. I've got my own pony, and that saddle is mine, and that ragged old slicker's for when it don't shine. The saddlebag holds everything that I own. I can work with others, but I work best alone. That old dog that trails me has never been mine. He just seems to like me, and I think that's fine. He's mangy and dirty, but like me, he don't steal. If you take me on, he's part of the deal. To me, he's exactly what partner's about. Sometimes he leads because he knows the best route, and sometimes he trusts me to make the right call. He seems to know neither of us know it all. So point me to where the work's to be done. I'll peel off my saddle when there's no more sun, and when she comes up in the morning again, well, all I've ever known is to ride for the brand. You won't see no wing holes in the back of my shirt, and if I have a halo, it's covered in dirt. But there are no horns or a long forked tail, no crown of thorns, not a sign of a nail. Just a man who learned young about honor and pride, and the sheer joy of living in a straight trail to ride. I'll stand with your children. I'll bleed for your land. As long as we're square, I ride for the brand. I know when it's time when our trails hit a fork, and it will, because that's how the world works. I'll pack up my gear, and we'll ride away. Me and old dog know your gate swings both ways. But out there somewhere, just around the next curve, there's bound to be another brand we can both serve. We'll ride up to his bunkhouse, hoping to find brand riders wanted on an old cardboard sign.
Well, if you are in the range of CFCW 840 AM today, stay tuned for Country Classics with Pete Hicks right after The Spirit of the West. And thank you so much for joining up and riding along. And, of course, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And be sure to pick up the latest copy of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. You can subscribe online at CanadianCowboy.ca. And be sure to check out our YouTube channel where you can hear and watch this show and many others from our past. And you can also download it as a podcast. The links to do that are right there on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.